I'm Susana Medina, game designer at King. I've been working at King 4 years right now, and in other companies more or less 11 years in games. I want to start the talk with this sentence. I don't know if you know who is the man. Video games are bad for you. That's why they say about rock and roll. I want to start with this sentence by Shigeru Miyamoto, because when I was a kid, many people asked me, why do you like games? Don't you think that you are losing your time? Maybe it's only for kids, no. And every time I was bigger and bigger, it was the same question again and again. Why games? And when I was in the university studying advertising, not games, I was asking myself, I have to change. My first want was being game designer, why not now? So I changed completely. I did a master like you are doing right now, and I start working in games. Okay. And many people as well ask me if I only play games at my my time, and I'm only like games or video games, and no, I like a lot of things. This is, do you know what it is? And this? Game. All games, because I'm a collector, a game collector. Cartoons? Do you know? Humble. Retro games. Hip hop and graffiti. I love graffiti. Cats, obviously. My favorite game, Halo. More cartoons. My favorite food, sushi. Metroid. Do you know what it is?
Wrestling.
Do you know which band is? Beastie Boys is from the 80s. You are too young. This is a movie I like it a lot. The director is Billy Wilder, and it's called Some Like Hot. I don't know if you know. In Spanish, it was Con Faldas de a lo Loco. MF Doom, Mr. Fox, Pink Panther. So. What is that? It's a movie. Yeah. Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Ah, this is Matt Ryden.
I don't know what happened here.
Zelda, obviously, one of other of my favorite games. And music, My Patton, and cinema. I'm gonna show you a bit the games I've worked on. In the beginning, I was working in a small company in Madrid called Piro Studios or Piro Mobile. They did Commandos, but they have another section of mobile games. And these games I did 10 years ago or 11 years ago in Piro Mobile. And it was for G2ME. Do you know what it is? What of super old. It's like a code system for really, really old mobiles, like bricks. You remember the bricks, the first bricks? So we did this game for maybe with 5 megas or 10 megas. So imagine the quality of the graphics and the quality of the content and the content really poor and really short. But it was a really, really good for me learning this kind of games or code for these mobiles, because we did like in 3 months one game. And it was really, really good for me to start designing games. In three months, we had a new game. So it was really, really fast, the development. After that, I started working in Facebook and mobile games, but for iOS or for Android, really, really more for now. And we start with Pyramid Bill, Smoothie Tales, Bacterium. It was a game, a puzzle game for iOS, and Flash Games, and an iOS game for of Basket in iOS as well. Do you know what is iOS and what is Android, right? Okay. And after this, I start working in PC, Mac online games like Planet 51. I don't know if you know the movie. I did a game for iOS, a racing game, and yeah, and I collaborate with Petoons, Basket Dudes, that is a MMO, a basketball MMO, really peculiar. And now, again, I am working in a lot of games. I work on Candy Crush Soda, Scrubby Dabby, Diamond Digger, Pyramid, Diamond Darius. And now I'm working in a new game with narrative, really, really new from King, called Candy Crush Tales. I'm gonna show you a bit the game industry jobs. I don't know if you know, do you want to be producer, game designer, developer, but do you know everything about game industry jobs? Maybe not. Do you know what is a game designer, obviously, and the developers, the artists, the backend? Do you know what is a backend? This is a developer in charge of the backend, you know, the code that you don't see, you know, like the database and this stuff. Marketing guys, obviously. Producers, do you know what is a producer? Yeah? Could you tell me? Or anybody? No? A producer is in charge of the organization of a team and make it real. It's like the boss of the team. It's really, really generic, but it's more or less is this. And the QA? QA? Yeah? And what is his daddy? Or her daddy?
Try to make the game
some
minimums or some standards.
Yeah, they have to test the game, and there's a lot of QAs. Maybe there's a QA that is in charge of the gameplay, another QA is in charge of the tests. There's a lot of QAs. And the IT, you know, IT? No? IT is not a developer. So many people thought that it's a developer, it's information technology, but IT is the guy that, oh my goodness, what is that? Okay. I didn't realize, on you, sorry. Hey guys, amazing. Okay, let's continue. Okay. Okay, so the IT guys are in charge of if your computer is broken or is not working, you can ask the IT guys, okay? But there's more and more people in the game industry working, like Scrum Master, Data Scientist, Human Resources, Localization people, that is the are the people that is working in the translating all the game, all the tests from the game, Customer Service, that are the people that is answering all the questions and that the players wants to be clear. Okay. So the game is. I'm a game designer, so I want to explain you the game designer's jobs. So you can become lead designer, but before you have to choose between game designer, that is in charge of mechanics, systems, narrative designers, that is in charge of the creativity of the game, of the idea, or reacting all the text from the game, the text from the missions, the story obviously, and level designer. Level designer is in charge of design all the levels from the game. In many games are really, really different jobs. For example, I have a lot of friends from Mercury's team from Madrid, for example, and there the level designers are basically artists that makes everything with 3D maps, and they don't have to think about mechanics and history, nothing about that. But level designer in a company like King, like my actual company, must know about puzzles, different kind of game modes and mechanics, and they have to design these levels with all the tools we have. And if you are a really, really expert lead designer, one day you can be creative director. That in my company and many companies is a game designer, or worse, a game designer. How we work? So obviously you are super young and you don't work as I thought, you are not working right now. But in the game industry, when I started working maybe 11 years ago, I started working in a really, really small company, and we didn't have a methodology or a framework to work. That means that we work by task. So we have to finish the history, okay? We have to finish. So we have to design the a new mechanic for the next level. Okay, so we design. So I worked in a waterfall system. So we analyze. We have analysis, design, code, and test. So it was like step by step, but really without any methodology. Right now, I'm working in Agile. What is Agile? Agile is an Agile methodology that everything is planned by a really smart point of view, because you can, here. You can see we have a product backlog that basically is a list of tasks. Everything we have to do at the beginning, we plan everything, and we do a to-do list, really, really big, with everything we have to do. So every time we plan for a new feature, we check this super list and we take a task. So these tasks are reviewed every 15 days, for example. And when we finish, we do a demo with this task. And after, we do a retrospective. Then we analyze everything we did, and we improve in the next 2 weeks. So it's really sounds really, really boring, but it's really useful for work with a lot of people. And the most important thing for me of Scrum is that you can fail fast. So if you can see really, really fast if you are failing. But in the other system I worked, it was really, really difficult, because we didn't have any retrospective demo, and we worked like really, really big amount of days. So at the end, we didn't have time to solve all the problems. I wanna put you a video about the Scrum from, do you know Silicon Valley, the TV series? Yes, obviously, you are freaks like me. Okay. I don't know.
show you. Yeah, freaks now is a really mainstream word. It's not so cool. Into the in-progress column, and it stays there until it is ready for testing. Okay, this increases visibility into our team's progress. And that, gentleman, is Scrum. Welcome to the next 8 weeks of our lives.
This just became a job.
Okay, so here are the cards I'm adding under this epic for the ingestion engine. And there are three stories here. How long do we think each one will take?
I don't know, who cares?
4 hours apiece?
Yeah, maybe for you. Each one of those tasks would take me 3 max.
Not tasks, stories.
I've got a story. Why don't you choke on my balls?
Well, how about this? Why don't you each take one story, right? Okay. And we'll see who's right.
You see what he's doing, right? He's trying to get us to compete so we work faster. He thinks this wall of Psych 101 MBA mind control bullshit is going to motivate us.
Fine, don't compete. Do me at whatever speed you like.
Jared. I know these guys. I really don't think Scrum is going to work for them.
Oh, just trust in the system.
So we're going to work at a nice leisurely pace, right?
Sure.
But why are you typing faster?
I'm not. Maybe my leisurely pace is just a little faster than yours.
Cocksucker.
Oh, yeah.
So
Scrum, as you see in the video, we have a really, really big... When we usually work with a lot of people, we have like columns with all the work to do, in progress and done. So it's really easy, and every day we speak all together and we explain about what we did and what we have to do this day and every day with all the team. So it's really open and really fluid. I was forget. If you have some question, just raise your hand and I can say everything you want. So what is a casual game for you? Yeah.
A game that you play, a little time while you are going with the train or doing something that don't need your full concentration.
Mm-hmm.
So you can play with a game which don't get much time from your life.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What else?
A game that is made for people who usually play games.
Made for people that usually play games.
Don't
you? Okay. What else?
A game that is
Uh-huh. Okay. Very good. What else? Yeah?
Easy to learn.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What else? Anything else? No? Okay. So, casual game is a game, like you say, easy to play. But not hard to master, but with a bit of challenge. You can imagine. Well, you can imagine in your mind, or you can picture Candy Crush. It's easy. You can start playing immediately. Yeah. I think it's a really basic rule for a casual game. Anybody can play and can play super easy and immediately. Not too demanding on attention, as you said. You can play on the tube or in the bathroom, or say it's not so demanding for you. Short session, that is super important, because this type of games, not all the casual games are short session, but the casual game I am talking short sessions, because it's the casual game, it's a game that is not too demanding, so the short sessions are super important because you can play anytime. So if you have 5 minutes, you can play. You don't have to spend 2 hours or the full day. Cheerful teams, that is like a rule for all these kind of games. Thin error margin for balance between talents and skills. Progressive introduction of features with tutorial, implicit better, of course. All the casual games that I work in, work on, really have all this progressive introduction of features. So that is that means that it's easy to understand as well, because you are introducing step by step. You are introducing a really hard levels from the beginning. All these casual games have this character. So the casual core play, do you know casual core gameplays? Can think on, for example, we have, puzzle. Yeah, dice, for example, dice. Mahjong, yeah. Word games, card games, casino, trivia, pachinko. Do you know what is pachinko?
Yeah.
You love Japanese things. Bingo. Hidden objects and resource management, mastery. This is three examples from King with different core gameplays, casual core gameplays. Alphabet Saga was a word game. Pyramid is a card game, obviously, and Paradise Bay is a resource management. I'm going to explain the mastery mechanic. Do you know which game was the first in using this mastery mechanic? And which year? Yeah. No? 80-something, I thought. Yeah. It was Chainsaw by Moribe in 1985. The next is some kind of mastery mechanic, obviously, Tetris in 85, in the same year, and after these two, Sakiri in 1994. That is, for me, is the first mastery, real mastery game. And in King, we can see a lot of examples of mastery. This is a Candy Crush and Candy Crush Jelly. This is another match 3 that we are using in King. It's a clicker. Do you know Toon Blast, for example? This is a clicker. A bubble shooter is really popular right now. Linker. In the linker, you have to link 3 of the same color in order to clean all the board. So it's the same mechanic but with different. And the slider. The slider is a match 3, but you have to slide the pieces. Concepts in match 3 games. Skill, pattern recognition, anticipation, strategy, depth, we have game modes, gameplay modifiers, envelope. I want to explain later all these concepts. Variety, the lack, and the game modes. Chain goals, way to play, score, and time levels. Hardcore. Best practice in level design. In game design. In casual gameplay. The core gameplay has to be fun. That is, I think, this is the most important thing. You analyze a casual game, all the casual games are fun. So this is essential. Short gameplay loops. I explained you before the short periods of time playing, but the short gameplay loops means that you are playing a really a short loop, gameplay loop. So maybe you are collecting, you are gems, you win coins, and after you are playing again. So it's like super fast, and that is maybe so addictive. Require low intensity skills, but at the same time, depth to provide. Puzzle is the key word, but at the same time can be a no-brainer, like you said. So you can play without effort. And many people use this kind of casual games to relaxing, to relax or to forget everything we have in mind. Difficulty is less important than variety, and luck plays an important part. So I'm gonna explain you, because I was working at Kim almost 2 years and a half as level designer. I'm gonna explain you the level design in Kim. Maxi Puzzle level design. Okay, this is an example of level design in a lot of levels. So you have to use a tool to design the level. So this tool is made. Maybe it's a program that you download, but in a lot of companies, the company do this tool, make this tool always. And this tool is designed in between the developers and the designers, because the designer has to design levels and has to be being part of, you know, this tool. The first thing I want to explain is the layout. When this is an example from Candy Crush Soda. This is the editor, it's from the editor. And the first thing when I design a level, the first thing I have to think of is the layout. It's like I make drawings in my mind, or I make drawings in my notebook, and I want to, okay, I'm gonna make a level with SOS, or I'm gonna make a level with a shape of a swarm, for example. So the first thing I do is this, the layout. This level I did for Soda is my inspiration was Qbert. This level, my inspiration was Tatiana, is a famous designer, game designer, and a friend. Is really, really good, and it's like a cat, because she has two cats, and it's one of her cats. This level I call Boops and Sabrina. This is a real name we have in the level editor in Sweden. So this level is called Sabrina, because it has really, really two big boobs. So the variety in level design. At the beginning I showed you the layout, is the board size and the board shape is really, really important. Not only for taking it inspiration, but because the board size means difficulty, and means difficulty means a lot of things. If you are doing a small board, you have less possibilities in a puzzle to play. So you have to play with all these things. The usual grid in casual games, in puzzle games, match 3 is 9x9. We are using only one board, but right now we have games with a lot of long boards. That means that the board continues until finish. We have different shapes. The amount of colors is really important, because if you are using less color, it's easier. Set spawn rate, I want to show you later, but basically the spawn is the probability you are giving every column in colors, in shapes, and everything. This is not important, the composition, the layout, the grind, surprises, and I want to explain later this. Spawner. let's say the spawner, every column has a spawner. Is there? In Candy Crush Soda it's really visible, but in a lot of games you cannot see the spawner. The spawners, you can edit this spawner and put everything you want. I can put the colors, the amount of probabilities of colors, the amount of fishes, that is a special candy, the amount of blockers, and I will explain to you later what is a blocker, and everything in the spawner. So the spawner define all your level. Blockers and helpers. The blockers and helpers support the core gameplay, so they are easy to remember, not so many types in the game, can move or moves or not, can fall, destroyed by mats, or destroyed by not near, destroyed by explosion, or destroyed by a specific piece. I will show you the blockers. In Candy Crush Soda, we have a lot of blockers, a huge amount of blockers, but at the beginning, these are like the basic ones. We have this, that is a licorice swirl, and this is a blocker, so it's not a gameplay emblem you have to play with, so it's blocking your gameplay. You have to destroy this element to clean all the board. So when you design a level, this is like the basic layout. So I put all the pieces here. I design the layout. This is a suitcase. I put all the candies. I put one yellow, one blue. I put a blocker here, more blocker. There is a chain reaction blocker. It's super cool. And this is another element that is a power up. It's a special candy. It's called cake. And this cake, you have to match 8 times in order to explode. And this is another blocker, this is called cupcakes, and you have to match close to this to disappear, these blockers. And this is more blockers, ice blockers, that covers all the candy. So you design all these blockers, candies, and everything, and press play. And you have to play this level. So the first move will be this, for example, and I destroy this blocker and these two. And every blocker has a different behavior. In this case, are really, really similar. So you design this level and you play this level, and you have to pass this level, obviously. And you finish this level is when you think that is fun enough. Blockers and helpers. So these blockers and helpers that will work in all game modes are useful, have nice effects. Some error that we can put these blockers and helpers on the board. When I design a level, I design without the use of booster. Do you know what is a booster? It's a little.
If you have to try all of the games, all of the levels that you have designed, the last levels of each game, like Candy Crush or games like this, that are supposed to be more difficult than the others, could be possible that you cannot complete the level, but you let it try to another person, and things like that.
Yes. You cannot. Maybe I cannot complete a level from another designer, for example. But when I design a level, I have to finish this level, because if not, I don't know if the player will be finished this level. And we make a lot of tweaks, life tweaks, for example. We design every 15 days, more or less, King release new levels in all the games. So the designers, we have 2 weeks, finish 20 or 40 levels. I don't know, maybe more. And we design, we finish the level, we put the moves, blah, 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 blah. And after that, we have analysis of all the levels that the BP guys does, and we have like a big Excel with all the levels and the tries and the losings and everything, all the information. So we can check if we have a level that is super difficult, for example, and nobody passed this level. So this is a killer. We used to call killer this level, and we tweak this level and we change, adding moves. That's really easy. Sometimes it's not so easy making difficult or easier a level, and we have to change all the layout. But yeah, I finish all my levels, and all the designers finish only at least once. We don't used to have an impossible level. It's impossible. Our main goal is make it fun. So in King we have really like 300 million of users. So it's not a big deal making difficult, because there's a lot of people paying. No worries about that. We have to have challenging games, challenging puzzles, but not difficult. Easy. And now we are seeing that the market is changing, because maybe two years ago we used to have a lot of hard levels. But right now we are Toon Blast, for example, is a good example that they have a really, really easy level from the beginning, but they have more levels than us. So that is like a sign of the people wants content, not really, really difficult levels. So yes, you have to pass at least once. So you have to make it fun and easy. Yeah.
But how do you make the probabilities, for example, for a Jabu candy to sell fair?
Yeah, fair. We don't used to have an unfair probabilities. For example, if you have to collect red candies in the level, you always will have the same probability in all the colors. This is like a forbidden thing, because it's not fair for the player, and the player feels that something is strange here. Like, what happened with the red candies? It's not good. It's a not good practice. No. And this is another thing. But another question about the no. Okay, a good practice as well is giving some helpers or special candies on the board. It's really, really fun for the players, and they love these kind of things. The scoring is changing, because right now in all the games we have in Candy, we have the score, and many people I have one star in this level, or I have two stars. It's related with the score. But right now, I am analyzing all the casual games from the market. I am seeing that the score is not so important. So maybe in the future we will remove the score. Not in King, in a lot of companies, because it's not so important. This is a finished level. I saw you at the beginning in the editor, and this is the playable level with all the blockers and the candies. The saga map. Do you know what is a saga map? Yeah? Yeah, it's the map with the levels. Do you like Mario Bros?
Yeah,
Super Mario Bros?
I was going to say it's like a Mario Bros.
Yeah. Many people thought, many casual players thought that the saga map was created by King, but it's not a It's not created by King. We can play Super Mario World, for example, and see a saga map. It's like we have stations covering all the map, and we have to go step by step. And it basically is for telling I am level 3, and that is good for giving a sense of progression to the player. So it's progressing. I have to reach the house, and I have to finish this level and see what is next. So we try removing the saga map, and we have games in the market right now that they don't have saga map. For example, again, Toy Blast, and it's working for them. But for the moment, we have all the games. We're still with the saga map because we think that the player have a sense of progression with this. Do you think so?
Yeah.
The difficulty. When I start working in games, I work really, really different from right now, because right now we have a really big data team that give us everything. Everything is tracked. Wow. Oh, <hey. laughs> It's closing. Oh my goodness. You know what it is? What happened today? Okay. So before working at King, I used to think that the difficulty has to increase every level you play, right? But in casual games, for example, this kind of games, Doom Blast, Home Escapes, or Candy Crush, the difficulty is different because we have to give variety and sense of you are progressing, but it's no, you have to still playing, you know. So we cannot put a progression that is progressing every time you play, because it will be impossible to follow. And right now, this is a difficulty from Far Hero Saga, and we can see very easy, hard, and it's like increasing, decreasing, and that is. At the beginning, in the first 30 levels, for example, we have to put really, really easy levels just to play and just to hook the player to play more. But after 50, the difficulty is difficult, easy, and that is. So it's really different for a progression of a non-casual game, for example, that is increasing every time you're playing. The envelope. Do you know what is the envelope? Yeah, tell me.
Why does the difficulty have to go up and down every time?
To give variety. So the player tend to boring if they have a lot of difficulty levels or easy levels. By the way, for example, the game modes, we cannot put like five game modes in a row, because it's boring for the player. So that's the same for the difficulty. We have to give variety and give them opportunities to play and to fail and to win and to feel and it's progressing. The envelope. Right now at King we have the saga map and we don't have like a meta game. But in other games like Home Escape, do you know Home Escapes?
No.
No? Garden Escapes? Yeah? This Garden Escape or Home Escape, the envelope is different. We don't have only match 3 levels. We have like a house that we have to improve every time we play levels. We win stars, I can remember I think it's coins or... So winning coins, you are improving your house every time you play. So it's different. The sense of progression is not
only winning stations, and it's like improving your house. Let's see. Oh, what else? In many people tend to think that casual games doesn't have narrative, but they have. For example, Candy Crush has a history, and all the characters have histories and designs with narrative. The story of the character, that this character knows another character, is that way. So we have a lot of narrative in these games. Many people think that is not true, but sometimes the narrative is so silly. For example, I remember the example at the beginning from, I can't remember, Sonic or Mario. At the beginning, it's really simple. So, but it has narrative design. The tweaks. Every time we release a new game, we have to tweak really, really fast. So right now in the industry, is really important the tweaks. 10 years ago, when I started working, we didn't download new content every week or every day. But now we are used to, because of internet, we have to download content almost every day. If you play your console, maybe in 2 weeks you have to upload a game or download the new system upgrade, and it's crazy. So right now we are like working in a living game. It's not like before. So the tweaks are really important, and the casual games are essential, because if we are losing players because it's super difficult, we can change really fast this. We can change moves, we can change the levels, and the tweaks are upload and it's done. The UX and the interaction is really an important concept that maybe you must search by internet, because the US right now is really important at King and in other companies. The experience, the icons we are showing in our games, the sizes, the space, everything is important in the game. And the live content, as I mentioned.